اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. The topic of this Jummah khutbah of mine is Islam, the religion of peace. Islam comes from the root word salam, which means peace. It's also derived from the Arabic word film, which means to submit your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam in short means peace acquired by submitting your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad said that spread peace. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 54, وَإِذَا جَاءَكَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِآيَاتِنَا سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. Whenever you meet someone who believes in our sign, wish them assalamu alaikum. May peace be on you. This is a greeting which has been prescribed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, that whenever one Muslim meets another Muslim, whenever a mu'min meets another mu'min, you have to wish salam. Assalamu alaikum. May peace be on you. And if you compare this, it is mentioned also in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 86. وَإِذَا جَاءَكَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ, says that when anyone greets you courteously, greet back more courteously or at least the same. Means Allah commands us that if anyone wishes you or greets you, you have to greet back more courteously or at least the same. For example, if someone says assalamu alaikum, you have to reply wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. If someone wishes to you assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, you have to reply wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Or if someone says assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh, if you cannot improve, at least say wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. If someone says assalamu alaikum, you'll be like wa alaikum assalam. The words are same, but it's coming from depth of your heart. The tone is better. So even this is called as a better greeting. So in Islam, it is compulsory, if someone greets you, you have to greet back more courteously or at least the same. Now if you compare this greeting of religion of Islam, the religion of peace, as compared to other greetings, today in the world, the most common greeting is good morning. Khuyumora in Afrikaans. Very common. And even if it's raining cats and dogs, it may not be a good morning, yet you say good morning and you have to reply by good morning. What is so good in that morning when it is flooded, it's raining heavily? And I remember in school when I was there, and even today, most of the schools, when the teacher enters the classroom, everyone says, good morning, sir. And the teacher replies, good morning, students. Maybe he had a fight with his wife. He may be cursing the morning, that such a morning should never come back in his life. Yet, he has to wish back good morning. If you compare this greeting with the universal greeting of Islam, assalamu alaikum, may peace be on you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, may peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on you. It is a universal greeting. The religion of Islam, which is the religion of peace, not only shows you how to acquire peace, it shows you that it is your duty to spread peace. But today we find in the world that if you see the international media, whether it be the international newspapers, the broadcast channels, on the internet, in the magazines, there is virulent propaganda regarding Islam. We find that the international media is bombarding misconception of Islam, and it is calling Islam as a religion, unfortunately, of terrorism, na'uz billah, a religion of violence. Because they are afraid of the spread of this religion of peace. And we find the media commonly blaming and saying, oh, Muslims, the extremists, they are fundamentalists. What is the meaning of the word fundamentalist? A fundamentalist by definition means a person who follows the fundamentals of one particular subject. For example, and if a person wants to be a fundamentalist in a particular field, he should know, follow and practice the fundamentals of that subject. For example, if someone wants to be a good mathematician, he should know, follow and practice the fundamentals of maths. Unless he is a fundamentalist in the field of maths, he cannot be a good mathematician. For a person to be a good scientist, he should know, follow and practice the fundamentals of science. Unless he is a fundamentalist in the field of science, he cannot be a good scientist. You can't paint all fundamentalists with the same brush that all are good or all are bad. Depending in which subject, in which field is a person a fundamentalist, you have to label him accordingly. If you have a fundamentalist robber whose profession is to rob and steal, he is bad for the society. If you have a fundamentalist doctor whose profession is to save thousands of human lives, he is good for society. So depending on which field is a person a fundamentalist, you have to label him accordingly. You can't paint all with the same brush. As far as I am concerned, I am a fundamentalist Muslim and I am proud to be a fundamentalist Muslim because I know, follow and I strive to practice the fundamentals of Islam. And I know that there is not a single teaching of Islam which is against humanity as a whole. There may be certain teachings of Islam who the non-Muslims or the media may blame because they may not know the context or the logic behind the teaching. I challenge anyone to point out a single fundamental teaching of Islam from the Quran or from the Sahih Hadith which is against humanity as a whole. And if you read the Webster's dictionary regarding the meaning of the word fundamentalism, it says that fundamentalism was a movement that started in the early part of the 20th century in America by the Protestant Christians. And they protested against the church and they said, not only is the message of the Bible from God, every word, every letter of the Bible is from God. If someone can prove that every word, every letter from the Bible is from God, it's a good movement. But if someone can prove that every word, every letter of the Bible is not from God, it's not a good movement. When we read the Oxford Dictionary, it says, the definition of the word fundamentalist, it says that fundamentalist is a person who strictly adheres to the ancient teachings of any scripture, of any religion. But now when you read the latest revised edition of Oxford Dictionary, there's a slight change. It says that fundamentalist is a person who strictly adheres to the ancient teachings of any scripture of any religion, especially Islam. So the word especially Islam has been added. The moment you hear the word fundamentalist, you start thinking of a Muslim. And we Muslims go on the defense. No, I'm not a fundamentalist. I'm not an extremist. I tell, I am an extremist. I'm extremely kind, I'm extremely loving, I'm extremely just, I'm extremely honest. Quran says, you have to be extremely kind, extremely loving, extremely honest. You cannot say I'll be partly honest. When it benefits me, I'm honest. When it does not benefit me, I'm not honest. And can someone tell me what is wrong in being extremely kind, extremely honest, extremely loving, extremely just? We should be extremists in the right direction, not in the wrong direction. We Muslims today are being targeted by the media and by the enemies of Islam, and we are being maligned. And this religion of peace is being called as religion of violence. And today, one of the most misunderstood words in Islam is the word jihad. It is not only misunderstood by the non-Muslims, it is even misunderstood by the Muslims. Most of us think that any war fought by any Muslim for any reason whether it be for personal gain, whether it be for wealth, whether it be for fame, whether it be for land. Any war fought by any Muslim is called as jihad. Jihad does not mean any war fought by any Muslim for any reason. Jihad comes from the Arabic word jahada, which means to strive, which means to struggle. Jihad means to strive and struggle. In the Islamic perspective, it means to strive and struggle against one's own evil inclination. Jihad also means to strive and struggle to make the society better. Jihad also means to strive and struggle against oppression. Jihad also means to strive and struggle in self-defense in the battlefield. So jihad basically means to strive and struggle. If a student is striving and struggling to pass the examination, he's doing jihad. And many people have a misconception that jihad can only be done by Muslims. There are no less than two verses in the Quran which say that even non-Muslims did jihad. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Luqman chapter number 31, verse number 14, we have enjoined on the human beings to be kind to the parents. In travail upon travail did the mother bore you, and in pain did she give you birth. The next verse, Surah Luqman chapter 31 verse number 15 says, but if your parents do jihad, strive and struggle to make you worship somebody else besides Allah, of whom you have no knowledge, then do not obey them, yet live with them with love and companionship. Allah repeats the message in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 8. We have enjoined on the human beings to be kind to the parents. But if the parents do jihad, strive and struggle, to make you worship somebody else besides Allah, of whom you have no knowledge, do not obey them. Here, Allah is talking about non-Muslim parents who are doing jihad, striving and struggling to make the children do shirk. This type of jihad is called as jihad fi sabil shaitan. What we Muslims should do is jihad fi sabilillah, strive and struggle in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So normally when we use the word jihad, it's understood it is jihad fi sabilillah, unless otherwise. And today we find in the media, in many of the books written by Orientalists, they translate the word jihad as holy war. If you translate holy war into Arabic, it is Harbun Muqaddasa. This word Harbun Muqaddasa, holy war, is nowhere to be found anywhere in the Quran. Nowhere to be found anywhere in the Quran. There is no single hadith, Sahih hadith of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, where the word Harbun Muqaddasa is used. It's a mistranslation. This word holy war was first used to describe the crusades of the Christians, when they spread the religion with force and killed tens and hundreds of thousands of human beings. It was called as crusades, the holy war. And today, this word unfortunately is used for the Muslims. We Muslims, it is our duty that we convey the correct message of Islam to those who are not aware of it. And it's a duty that we remove the misconception and we spread the correct message of peace. Today, it's very common that many Muslims, they're labeled as terrorists. What is the meaning of the word terrorist? Terrorist by definition means a person who causes terror. And we know many a times this label, one label is given, there are two different labels given to the same person for the same activity. For example, I come from India, and more than 70 years back, when India was being ruled by the Britishers, many Indians, they fought for the freedom of the country. These people, by the media, they were called as terrorists. The Britishers, they called these people as terrorists. But we Indians, we call these people as patriots, as freedom fighters. Same people, same activity, two different labels. If you agree with the view of the Britishers that they had a right to rule over India, you would call these people as terrorists. But if you agree with the view of the common Indians that the Britishers came to India to do business, they have no right to rule over us, you would call these people as freedom fighters, you'd call them as patriots. Same people, same activity, but two different labels. So before you give a label, you have to find out for what cause is the person striving. And when I address to the Indian media, I ask them a simple question. The Britishers, more than 80 years back, they called Bhagat Singh as a terrorist. Do you agree with it? They said no. I said why? No, we know the Indian history. They were freedom fighters, they weren't terrorists. So I asked the Indian media, when you don't agree with the Britishers 70, 80 years back, when they called Bhagat Singh a terrorist, why do you follow the British media today when they say Muslims are terrorists? They start laughing. That time you didn't agree with them. You said we did research, we know the history. So why aren't you doing research today? When the Western media or when the media is calling someone a terrorist, why don't you do research? And you have several such examples. We have the example of America. Before, a few hundred years back, in 1775, when the Britishers were ruling America, there were many Americans who were fighting for the freedom. At that time, the Britishers said George Washington was terrorist number one. Later on, America gets his freedom and George Washington becomes the first president of USA. Imagine, terrorist number one of the world becomes the president of USA. We have several such examples. Few decades earlier, when the white apartheid government was ruling South Africa, the white apartheid government, they imprisoned Nelson Mandela and called him the terrorist number one of the world. And they imprisoned him in Robben Island for more than 25 years. Later on, he's released and he becomes the president of South Africa. Imagine, terrorist number one of the world becomes president of South Africa. And later on, he's also given the Nobel Prize for Peace. Imagine, terrorist number one in the world is given the Nobel Prize for Peace. So what we realize, not that he was bad and he became good, for the same activity for which he was imprisoned, later on he was given the Nobel Prize for Peace. So what we realize today, media is powerful. Whatever the media says, whether right or wrong, that label gets stuck to a person. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Hujurat, chapter number 49, verse number 6, that whenever you get information, always check it up before you pass it on to the next person. And today we find in the international media, because Islam, mashallah, is a religion of peace, they talk about war for peace. It's not war for peace, it is war on peace. It is war on Islam. It is the duty of every Muslim that we see to it that we remove this misconception. They are trying their level best to see to it that whichever Dai is spreading peace, they want to label that is spreading violence so that they don't want the religion of Islam to spread. It is the duty of every Muslim that he sees to it that he follows this religion of peace of Islam and he propagates peace and spreads it throughout the world. إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Today, one of the most common misconceptions spread is that the religion of Islam was spread by the sword. If you translate, Islam means peace. They are saying that peace was spread by the sword. The best reply given to this allegation is by Delisi Oleri, a very famous historian who writes in the book on page number 8, Islam at the Crossroad. He says that history makes it clear that the legend of fanatical Muslims sweeping across the world, forcing Islam at the point of the sword, is the most fantastic, absurd myth that historians have ever repeated. I would like to repeat the statement of Delisi Oleri, a very famous historian, who said in his book, Islam at the Crossroad, page number 8, that history makes it clear that the legend of fanatical Muslims sweeping across the world, forcing Islam at the point of the sword, is the most fantastic, absurd myth that historians have ever repeated. We Muslims, we ruled Spain for about 800 years. Later on, the Crusaders came, they wiped out the Muslim. There was not a single Muslim who could openly give the Azan. We Muslims, we ruled India for about 1,000 years. If we wanted, we could have forced every non-Muslim to accept Islam at the point of the sword. We did not do it. Today, in India, 80% of the Indians, they are non-Muslims. These 80% non-Muslim Indians, they are giving shahada, they are bearing witness that Islam wasn't spread by the sword. Today, the country which claims to have the largest population of Muslims in the world, it is Indonesia. I'm asking you the question, which Muslim army went to Indonesia? Malaysia has more than 60% Muslims. Which Muslim army came to Malaysia? Which Muslim army went to the east coast of Africa? Which sword? We find from history that in these places, Islam was spread because of ikhlaq, because of the way the Muslims followed their religion, how they spread this religion of peace. And there was a survey done, which appeared in the Plainsuit magazine, as well as the Reader Rajab Al-Mainik book in 1984. It was a survey of the increase in the major world religions in a span of 50 years. From 1934 to 1984, it gave the increase of the major world religion in a span of 50 years. And number one religion that increased maximum was Islam, 237%. Christianity, only 47%. I am asking the question, which war took place between 1934 and 1984 which made millions of people accept Islam? Which war? Today, the fastest growing religion in America is Islam. Today, the fastest growing religion in Europe is Islam. The fastest growing religion in the world is Islam. The more they are attacking Islam, alhamdulillah, the more it is spreading. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Imran, chapter 3, verse 54. Allah says, Makru makrallah, wallahu khairul makrin. They planned and plotted. Allah too planned. Allah is the best of planner. The more they are maligning Islam, the more it is spreading, alhamdulillah. Today the world is saying, Islam does not give rights to the woman. Do you know, out of those people accepting Islam, two-thirds are women. 66% of the people accepting Islam are women. Why are the American women accepting Islam if Islam subjugates the woman? Why are the European women accepting Islam if Islam subjugates the woman? Because Islam has the solution to the problems of humanity. Islam has the solution to the problems of women. It is Ad-Dinul Haqq. And it is our duty that we propagate this religion of peace. But Allah has promised in the Quran, in no less than 3 different places. In Surah Tawbah, chapter 9, verse number 33. In Surah Saf, chapter number 61, verse number 9. And Surah Fatah, chapter number 48, verse number 28, Allah says, Huwa allazi arsala rasulahu bilhuda wa dinil haqq liyudhira wa al-din kulli. That Allah sent His messenger with the religion of truth so that it will prevail over all the other religions, over all the other isms. And Allah says that Allah is enough as a witness. Allah says, وَقَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. And in two places Allah says that هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِهِدَىٰ وَالدِّينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. Allah sent His messenger with guidance and the religion of truth so that it will prevail over all the other religions, over all the other isms, however much the mushrik don't like it. وَقَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. And enough is Allah as a witness. This is a promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This religion of haqq will prevail over all the other religions, over all the other deen. Allah says in Quran, in Surah Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 19, Inna deena indallahi al-Islam. The only religion acceptable in the sight of Allah is Islam. And the reply to this sort of Islam is very well summarized by Adam Pearson, who says that people who worry that one day nuclear weaponry will fall in the hands of the Arabs, they fail to realize that the Islamic bomb, the bomb of peace, has already been dropped. It fell the day Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was born. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وعذاب النار. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وعذاب النار. والأصل إن الإنسان في خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. آخر السلام.